Our project today combines Tim Holtz's collection folio, the Wallflower paper stash, and numerous ideology bits which come together to create a beautiful botanically themed project filled with ephemera, embellishments, and hidden treasures. The elements of this project can be personalized, or you can alter the theme to suit a holiday, family event, or personal milestone. The collection folios are a wonderful blank canvas just waiting for you to begin your creative adventures. There are any number of ways that you can decorate and embellish the inside and outside of your collection folio. I've chosen to use some black distress paint and papers from the Wallflowers 12x12 paper pad. And I'm using a select group of papers. I'm not mixing and matching a lot of different ones in there. I think that creates a little bit of continuity, and I like the way that it helps my eye move in and attach to various places. But having said that, you can certainly do whatever it is that you want to. So let's talk just for a minute about the collection folio as it comes from the package. And I've already started to work with this a little bit, but it's basically these two outer flaps that are your top and your cover, and this flap over here. And then there's a top and bottom flap, and there's this elastic. Let's see if we can get that to fold back and stay. And this is the spine. Now, this is a cascading spine, and ultimately what we're going to do is we'll fold this right on the stitching, but for now I'm going to put it to one side because we're not even going to talk about it right now. You'll notice that on my folio, I'll bring mine back in, if I turn this over, you can see the openings where the elastic goes through, but I've taken them off and I'm not going to put them back on, primarily because I don't want them to get hooked up in my birds and to get hooked up on my knob, which I've chosen to use. Again, whatever you want to do, you can. And these are decisions sometimes you make ahead of time, sometimes you make as circumstances happen. I thought I was going to put the elastic back on, but then when I realized that I had these raised elements on here, I knew that that wasn't going to work, so I went ahead and put the knob on. But we'll talk about all that eventually too. So what you need to do is just feed the little metal tab of the elastic back through the openings and get that out of the way. Even if you plan to use it, you have to get it out of the way to sort of do the preliminary work. Now, again, let me bring this back in. If you look at my folio, you can see that I've used black distress paint, and I have gone deliberately against the whole solid coverage thing. I don't want opaque looks or an opaque look. What I want is this to kind of look worn and aged, and I think that it really does. Using the black but letting the craft show through, I think, really achieves that. So what I generally do is, obviously with distress paint, it's really easy because it's got the dabber top in there. Now the one thing, let's talk about this, one of the aspects of the collection folio. You can see these pre-scored lines here. This is so that you can fold these various flaps and covers in at different heights so that you can accommodate really thick pages or embellishments or whatever you happen to do. So in my case, what I've chosen to do is fold on the outermost group of lines here to allow the highest loft, if you will, all this open area in here. So all the measurements that I'm going to give you are going to assume that you're going to fold here and you're going to paint here, and we'll paint a little bit to the inside of each of these two areas so that when we get coverage with our paper, we will see all of this. I'm not going to paper this. I like it just painted, but we are going to paper right up to, I'm going to leave a quarter of an inch all the way around. So we're going to paper to within a quarter of an inch on this side and a quarter of an inch on this side. This will be black, and when it's folded up like this, again, you get all this loft in here, all this room to put dimensional elements. So again, all the numbers that I give you for cutout pieces are assuming, and let's just turn this way, are assuming the same thing, where I'm working with the outermost group here so that I can fold and get my dimension, and I'm going to fold in like this and get my dimension. All right, so having said that, let's come back and just talk about the distress paint. The one thing that I don't want is totally opaque coverage. I am deliberately being imperfectly perfect here and allowing a great deal of the craft to show through in some places. I want to do that so I get that kind of aged look going on. And when I think about covering these edges, because again, I'm going to come to within roughly a quarter of an inch of this fold, of this scored area, they don't have to be solidly covered with black either. Again, I think that that makes for a really interesting look. And quite honestly, because of the height that goes into these little scored areas, you can't really get down in there anyway unless you were using a brush, and really, you don't need to drag a brush out for this. It's just not necessary. Unless you want opaque coverage, and then by all means, go ahead. So again, let me just turn this. What I'm going to do is come around and do my roughly quarter an inch or so all the way around, being careful not to get perfect coverage. And I also want to do all these edges as well. And then I'm going to put this aside to dry. It's not going to take very long, but I will do all of this, including, this is now the back of my folio. I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm going to put some black paint along all of these scored areas, being careful not to cover everything up because I think that this looks good like this. I'm going to do that all the way around. Now, let's talk about paper. We'll just move this off to the side for a moment. Put that down. So let's talk about paper. This is some of the papers from the Wallflower Paper Stash, someplace here. Here's the cover that comes on the paper stash. So what you have is a group of 12 by 12 papers that look like this. And so these the elements on them take up the full 12 by 12 space. But then what Tim does is he'll take all of the designs that appear as 12 by 12 and he's going to shrink them down so that, let's see what I can see here, so that you get four on a page. Now I'm not actually seeing that here, so what these are the fronts and backs of all of the designs that are available as 12 by 12. So he'll take four of these fronts, if you will, he'll shrink them to 6 by 6 and arrange them on one 12 by 12 page. You're also going to get some 3 by 3 squares and some 3 by 4 rectangles. But what is important is that every time you see a page like this that has a front and a back, and you see pages like these two, which are identical, that have a front and a back, you have two of the full-size ones in the paper stash. If you find yourself needing more than that, if there's an element that you want to reuse, or if there's a particular back that you like a lot, you're going to need more than one. So just kind of think about that, and as you go along, you can make some decisions. Now, on the one that I've already got started, what I've done is I've repeated the use of the papers. I like the idea of having some continuity that way. I have seen some beautiful examples of these collection folios done where all the papers are different. This is just my thing, it's my style, and obviously we all have our own desires and likes and things that work for us. So this is what I've done. You can certainly do whatever works for you. But what I did was I used this paper here, and then I used it on the inside of the flap, and then you'll see that it's continued here. And then when I open these flaps, you'll see that there's craft. This is craft glassine right here that I've crumpled, and we'll talk about that. And I use that exclusively on the inside of this top and bottom flap. There's one paper that I used here in this center area, and then there's another paper. Let me slide this way. This paper is the same as this paper. So I've repeated that here and there, and then let me just close this back up. What I've done is I've come around and I've used one paper exclusively on the back. Now you'll see this element coming up, but I did use just this on the back. So you see the areas where the paint didn't fully cover, which I think looks great. So you kind of make some decisions about papers. Now in the case of the second one that I'm working on, I am using this paper instead of this. It's still green, and it's obviously it's got this geometric design, but I like this color. I like this way, the way that this looks, so I'm going to come back with the birds again. I want to kind of imitate what I've done, so I want to keep in the green. So what you have to do is think about your papers and how you want to use them. I know I'm going to repeat. Let's get this out of the way. I know I'm going to repeat. This is the back of this giant flower, which is beautiful, but I love the damask pattern on the back. So for my insides here, inside of the main flap and the inside of the smaller flap, I'm going to repeat that. I'm not going to repeat the use of this turquoise in here. Instead, I'm going to use this piece here. So I'm going to start cutting papers, and we'll talk about that, and then we're going to talk about how to adhere them on the insides and outsides of all of these elements. I've gone ahead and attached some of the cover papers, and I want to show you how this works, because with the exception of this very center piece in here, these all work the same way. And you'll notice that there are rounded corners on these pieces, and I'm using a handy-dandy tool to make rounded corners on my papers, and I'll show you that too. So the process, when I'm applying paper to the flaps or everything but this center piece, I like to actually put the score tape on the paper. I find it's a little bit easier for me to do that way. Now, again, I'm a big fan of score tape. It gets me in far less trouble than most other adhesives do, so that's what I'm using. If you want to use liquid glue or something else, then you, of course, can do that. Now, to accommodate this curve on these this flap here, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to trim this. But first I want to talk about dimensions. This front cover, again, if you want this same quarter inch reveal around here as I have done, and if you don't want to cover any of this area that's been scored so that you can get this, you know, this can accommodate really thick pieces, then these are the dimensions you're going to want to use. So for the front cover, I've cut my pieces 7.5 by 11.5. For the outside of this front flap, it's 1 3/4 by 11.5 inches. For these two top and bottom flaps that face upward like this, they both are cut to 4 1/4 by 7 3/4. When you talk about the inside of these flaps, so that's going to be here, this is going to be craft glossy, and we're going to talk about this separately in just a minute, but the one thing that I do want to tell you are the dimensions. But before you do anything in terms of measuring, this is how craft glossing comes off the paper stash that it's part of. And it's very smooth like this. And you'll notice that my piece is definitely not very smooth. I like this crumpled look. And that's part of the cool part about craft glossing. When you do this, you get all these really cool marks and crinkles that are in that coating. Now, I've actually done this. You can see that there's some larger areas here. If you go ahead and you do this a second time, you'll get the far more dense marks like I have here. Having said that, you need to do your crumpling before you do your cutting. Part of the process of doing this crumpling actually makes the piece shrink a little bit, and if you cut beforehand, you're going to end up with pieces that are too small. So crinkle your craft glassine, and then you're going to cut them to 4 1/4 by 7 3/4. When we talk about the inside of the front cover, which is this piece here, you're going to cut this to 7 3/8 by 11 3/8. The inside of this flap here, you're going to cut to 1 7/8 by 11 3/8. This is the main inside centerpiece. You're going to cut this 9 3/8 by 11 3/8. And then when we talk about the very back of this, you're going to cut this 9 1/2 by 11 5/8. Again, that's assuming you want the same reveal that I have. So let's talk about adhering these pieces. Let's just kind of get this out of the way. And I have a piece, wrong piece. I have a piece here. This is, again, I'm using the same papers. I like that look. So I have a piece that's already been cut to the correct dimensions. It has score tape on the back, and what I need to do now is come in and round the corner. So you just stick your paper right in that 90-degree corner. You go ahead and you punch it. I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. And you go ahead and you punch it. Now, what I like to do, and I've tried lots of different ways to go ahead and get these papers adhered onto these pieces, and whether I'm doing one of those 6x6 books that are made out of chipboard, or I'm doing something like this in the collection folios, for me, the best way to do this is to come and to actually release the backing paper on the score tape and then just set it lightly in place again. Everything else I have tried seems to result in crooked papers and a lot of aggravation, so this is what works for me. Now, obviously, when you're using a liquid glue, it's quite a bit more forgiving than it is to do this, but I'm willing to go through this aggravation simply because I get such better results. Now, by necessity, in order for this backing paper to release from the adhesive part of the score tape, it's slippery. So it's going to want to do this as you place it on here, and it does take a moment to go ahead and get this done correctly. So what I like to do is get this lined up where I want it to be, and then I want to come in and I want to release the score tape. Now I've got this the other way. Let me tip this so you can see. I find it's easier to do this if I peel the backing paper off the narrower piece of score tape first. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to get this on here. Now I'm holding this really tight here in an effort to not have this twist because I like the placement. So what I want to do is hold onto that really tightly and just come in here and get that paper to release. And all I'm going to do is peel it back. Now I'm going to make certain that nothing twisted before I go ahead and finish pulling the paper off. And that's going to allow me to just adhere that in place. And now what I can do is come in and I can peel the rest of the backing paper off. And this is simple as pie now. All I want to do is just press and bam, it's in place. Now if I think that there's not enough paint in here, I can come in very carefully and apply some more. I'm going to do the same thing. When you apply the craft glassine in here, it's the exact same process with one slight difference. Whether you try to round the corner with that punch before the glassine has been crumpled or afterward, it doesn't actually punch. So let me show you what happens. Again, I'm going to tuck it here in the corner, and I'm going to punch. And you can see that the paper doesn't actually cut. It just kind of bends and it sticks in there a little bit. But what it's done is give me a mark that I can cut on. So it marks the glassine enough so that I can see what I'm doing, whoops, to go ahead and round those corners. Now, is it perfect? Nope, but it's perfectly imperfect and I'm good with that. So I would come in and do the same thing here, and then I would go ahead, I would round this corner, and then I would go ahead and adhere this in place, and obviously I'll do that on the other flap. And then there's papers that I've chosen, I showed you that earlier, papers that I've chosen for the inside pieces here. These are all applied the same. The one that's going to be different is this center, whether you're doing the inside or, as I showed you a moment ago, when it's flipped over and you're doing the outside. Because you have to work around these eyelets that are in place that the elastic fits through. So you can see what I've done is I've put score tape so that it kind of comes around all of these openings here. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take my paper, and again, this is already pre-cut, and I'm going to lay it in here where it needs to be. And then what I'm going to do is use my finger and I'm going to press on that eyelet, and it's going to make a dent in the paper so I can see where to come back and punch it. You want to be careful that you don't let that paper shift when you're doing this. But you go ahead and you give that a good push. Now, I don't know if you're going to be able to see this. I know that I can see it. And I have, this is just a standard quarter-inch hole punch. But what I'm doing is I'm coming in here and I'm tilting the paper. And I know you can't see it, and I'm going to apologize for that. But I'm tilting the paper so that I can see the light reflect off of the bumps that the eyelets made. And I'm going to give that a punch. Now, I'm going to do the same thing for all of them. But what I will do is come in here and see how this fits. If I think that the hole needs to be elongated a little bit, I can do that, but typically I don't do that until I actually get all of the holes for the eyelets punched. Then I can put them down and I can see how everything aligns, and that's when I'll be able to tell if I have to ever so slightly elongate one of these holes to make everything line up properly. So I can get that on there, and then this one is here. All right, I can see that this one needs to be elongated. The hole is up a little bit too high, so I'm going to just come back with the punch, and I'm going to ever so slightly come down here and elongate that hole. And it's just a question of doing a little bit of fitting like that, and then it's the same process. Get the backing paper peeled off of the score tape so that it's loose, and then get your piece aligned, come back and get one of them lifted off, and then you can just start peeling them and applying the paper to the adhesive that's been revealed on the score tape. And then once you do that, it's time to start thinking about, obviously once you have all of your pieces covered, it's time to start thinking about some other things. Now in my prototype, which is not in arm's reach, I used Tim's, this is his layering stencil, the honeycomb pattern. I used that, and I used some walnut stained distress ink, and I like the mini blending tool. I find that I get better results with that. With the other tool, for whatever reason, I find that I tend to get smudges that are shaped like the rectangular shape of the foam. So this is what I do instead. And all I want to do is just randomly put some color on here through the stencil. And I'm just going to apply it really lightly. And there isn't any particular pattern that I have in mind. I just want to sort of connect some areas and then leave some undone, and I kind of make my way around the entire cover. And I will finish doing this after, but you can see how this looks. You get the secondary pattern that looks like it's kind of age and wear, perhaps, that are forming that honeycomb. Now I'm going to do that every place where this green paper is. So I'll do it on both of the tops of these flaps, I'll do it on the cover, and then I'll do it on this flap here. And then, once I get all the paper on here, I'll come back and we'll talk about all of the wonderful ways that you can embellish this. We're going to build our own embellishments, we're going to use lots of ideology pieces, and I'm going to show you how to make some really wonderfully unique embellishments for your collection folio. Embellishing the collection folio for me began with the cover, so that's what I'm going to start in terms of showing you. Now, I've got the one here that's already completed. There's one piece missing, and we're going to talk about that at the very end. But I want to talk about the elements that are on here and the ways that you can arrange them and various things that you can do. Now, obviously, we already talked about this. The cover paper that I used here is not the same as I used here, and this did factor into a couple of things that we'll get to, but primarily it factored into this big moth. If you look at the back of this paper, you can see that it is my background here. And when I cut this piece to fit the collection folio cover, I realized that when I did this, I actually cut this in such a way that I cut part of the moth's wing off. And so I was left more or less with this. And initially I was really unhappy that I had done that. And then I realized that there was nothing that said that I couldn't put this on and just have that cut piece end right against the edge of my paper. So that was a little bit of serendipity. I thought I was kind of in a mess there, and then I realized that I could make that work. These letters are these chunky letterpress letters from the letterpress letter set. Because they have a finish on them, you want to use something like the Aliens Super Thick Tacky Glue when you glue them in place. Because the finish kind of makes them glossy, you want to think about what the right adhesive is, and for me that's always going to be the Super Thick Designer Tacky Glue, because it will work on glossy surfaces. Now you'll notice that as the letters come from the package, they're all one color, but you can, if you want, you can sand these and you'll come right back to the bare wood, and then you can change the color so you can make your letters be anything that you want. There's the full alphabet included in the set. There are some numerals and just I think maybe one or two elements of punctuation. But by the time you get through, I mean obviously there's only one of everything, so there's a limit to how many words you can make, but certainly soar and fly work, and it leaves me with a fair amount. I still have some vowels left, so I can probably make some other words too. So that's this and the moth. Now this is a border from the Industrious Stickers Borders collection, and this is something that I've been using quite a lot lately. It really has become something that I've grown very fond of. And I'm going to use, this is the Pico version, I use the scallop version here, but I'm going to use this Pico version. Now I don't have a ruler in front of me, but there are some elements on here that I can use to align these so that I know that I'm reasonably straight. Now this element, as it comes from the package, is just a smidge wider than the paper on my cover, so I'm not going to trim this. I don't mind the fact that this overhangs a little bit, so I'm just going to go ahead and put that in place. Now I'm not pressing really hard just in case I want to adjust this, but these are self-adhesive, and unless you've touched the adhesive part on the back, there really isn't any reason that you should need to add extra glue unless you're putting it on something that maybe is non-porous. At that point, then you have to think about your adhesive and how that would work. But for the most part, this is just going to go on here really nicely. That's it for the Industrious stickers on the cover, but they definitely will be making appearances as we go a little bit further on. So there's that. Now, this element that is the bird and this piece right here, let me just pull those out. These actually come from one sheet of paper. This is from the 12 by 12 version, and you can see that the birds, well, this is a leaf that I'm not using at the moment, that you can see that the birds sort of came out of here, and then this piece came right out of here, and I'm using a rotary cutter when I cut the straight stuff because I get far better results that way. So all I did was, and again, I need to kind of turn this around so that they're going the same way now. What I did was I cut this off. I knew I didn't want this to come all the way over, but you can see that I've kind of trimmed this off. Probably even right here is what it looks like I did. And then I thought it was really important. And if you watched the video about the vintage 6x6 album that I did a few weeks ago, you heard me say the word layers over and over again. It's because they're so important. They really are critical to a really interesting page. You need layers. They give you depth. They give you depth perception. They give you lots of interesting things to look at. So they're really, really important. And in addition to layers, the other thing that is really important is to create some, what did I do with them? Here they are. You want to create some additional dimensions. So what these are the 3D foam adhesives made by Scrapbook Adhesives. And what you do, once you get through fussy cutting these little birds out, you put a bunch of them on the back. Now I probably have more on here that I want than I need, rather, but what I didn't want was for someone to touch this and there not be support here in the middle. So I put quite a few of them, and in a couple of places you can see these are a reasonable size. There are smaller ones. I have some here someplace. There's this smaller size. These are, I guess, 1/4 inch. The other thing that you can do is you can just cut these if you need to, and that's what I did. So this is flat on the surface, and then the birds are raised up with the 3D foam adhesives. And I'm looking upside down, so this is not going the right way there. That's more or less right. And then the other thing are going to be the botanical version of the remnant rubs. And this is a partial sheet, and you can see that I've already used some elements from that. So just the word legacy here, and the word create here, and then I have this number here. Let me slide this back. And then the word discover up here. these take 3 seconds to do, but they are such an effective way of adding some interest and texture. Now, the one big one, which I've already cut off of here, is this one that says figure 1 through 7, and I ran that along the side down here, right next to the bird, because I thought it looked really interesting that way, as though this were an element from one of the botanical books that you'd see in the 1800s. So that's kind of where this went, and then from there, someplace here, I have the curio knobs, which is what this came from. This knob right here came from, oh, here they are. All right, so they come in a package like this with 3. Now, any one of these will work. It just so happens that the open package I had, this was what was left, but you can see that you have multiple options. Now, something that I said a while ago that I want to reiterate, technically, this folio closes like this, but because I wanted to put the knob here and because I know I'm not going to use the elastics to hold it closed, I'm choosing to go like this with mine, and that allows me to put the knob on there. So let's just put this back for 1 second. We're going to pretend that the birds are lifted up. And then the other thing I want to talk about are the ornate plates. Now these come, there are 6 in the set, and they are fastened with brads like this. And I've chosen the white metal color here, kind of a nickel color. I used the rectangular one here kind of to emphasize this number, this set of numbers like this. You can use the oval if you want. If that's all you have available, then go, by all means, go ahead and use it. But the thing to bear in mind is if you do that, you're going to have to pick this piece up a little bit just to allow for a little bit more room, because this one is longer than the square opening or the rectangular opening one is. Now, as I said, they're fastened normally with brads, but I don't want to poke holes in this. So what I did was I pushed this through. And then if you just spread the legs on the brad and you kind of push them so that they fit the shape, let me turn that so you can see it. And then I use a little bit of the Aileen Super Thick Tacky Glue just to put them in place so that they don't move. And then when I'm ready, I have this all set to go. The holes in here are filled, the legs are tucked inside so that you don't see them, and then it's just a question of going ahead and gluing that in place. And that's really the cover. Now, this is what I did. You can do anything that you want, but I did want to give you A, some ideas, and B, an explanation of what I did in case you want to mimic this. I mean, I'm always flattered. If you think that this is good enough that you want to copy it, then by all means, go ahead. So for me, as I said, I started with the cover, and then from here, let's just move this one out of the way. From here, there are all kinds of fun things that go on. We have this stuff going on the inside of the front cover, and then the upper and lower flap we'll talk about, and then we'll also talk about these little creatures here, butterflies, moths, whatever they are. Again, this was a piece of paper that I cut because I needed the back side of it, and I turned it over and I had one of those oh poo moments when I realized I'd cut the wings off of these, but again, I decided that if it worked here and I could do it, then it certainly would work here. So we'll come back. I'm going to talk about all these elements shortly. Before we move on to the inside of the folio, I do want to talk just a moment about the cover. You can see that on my new version here, I've gone ahead and used the white curio knob. I was a little skeptical at first. I wasn't certain that that was going to work, but I think that it's just fine. And I did go ahead with the oval ornate plate as opposed to the rectangular one here on my original. The birds are the same. I didn't have any more of these rub-ons, so I just substituted something else here. It works just fine. You saw this a few moments ago. Rather than the word here, I just used one of the botanical rub-ons and put this little butterfly. Now, the other thing that I do want to talk about is our image here that is this big moth. I've basically done the exact same thing, but this time, rather than apply it flat to the surface of the cover, I used, these are the 3D foam stickers, I used these underneath along this edge and about to here, and I have this raised up. But then what I did was glue the edge right along here to align with the edge of the paper so that this is pretty secure here, but I've got some loft here, which I like. I think that adds a little bit of interest, because if I'm going to say it once, I'm going to say it 1,000 times. Layers are important. And sometimes even just lifting something a little bit like this can be really cool. Now, I have not put the letterpress letters on yet, but I do want to show you something interesting that you can do. As I mentioned earlier, you can take and sand these. Now, let's just not get sand dust all over everything. But I can show you how easy this is. This is just some fine sandpaper. And all I'm doing is sanding the top of the letter. And you can see the difference. This starts to become older, older looking, more worn looking. And I just think it ages it a little bit. If I wanted to, I could sand this off entirely and come back and put another color on there. But I think that for the purposes of this one, I think I'm just going to go ahead, sand these a little bit, and then I'll use the super thick tacky glue, the designer tacky glue, to adhere them to the cover. Because again, the backs are shiny, and they're basically, they become non-porous once you put that finish on there. And so I want to be certain that they adhere. So there's going to be my cover. This is more or less what it's going to look like. Let me move this back in so you can see. And I'm really satisfied with this. I like the way it looks. It's moving forward and it looks really good. So let me move the letters to one side. Let me move the second folio out of the way for a second, and let's turn our attention specifically to the inside of the front cover. I want to show you how I created all of this. I'm going to talk about the arrow adornment and a few other things, but let's start with this piece right here. This is a cover of some kind of a journal that I'm certain was, you know, produced in the 1800s, and it comes from one of the large 12 by 12 versions of the papers from the wallflower pad. This is just a piece of paper, in fact it's this right here, that I cut out so that it was a little bit bigger to allow this border around here. And then I came in, again, let me just show you what I've got going here. I came in with my mini ink blending tool and walnut stain, and all you do is just go ahead and come around, and it just darkens the edges a little bit. There's, you know, nothing serious going on there, but I think that it's important. It adds a really nice look. So let's talk also about the other elements on here. This is from the Industrious Stickers Frames and Border Set. This is one of the oval frames that's on there. This little special delivery sticker, or it's actually not a sticker, you have to glue it in place, but this little item here and the parcel post both come from one of the ephemera packs. There's one called Travel and one called Thrift Shop, and I think these both come from the Travel ephemera pack. Having said that, this bingo card and I believe this circle here, these all come from the Thrift Shop pack. And what's really important that we're going to get to in a moment are these wonderful cutouts. Let me see if I can find the third one. I have one in use. Here they are. You get these little guys. You get three sizes of them, and they are part, if I'm not mistaken, of the Thrift Shop ephemera pack. And these are wonderful. I know I'm going to use at least one and probably more as I go forward. So let's come back and we'll talk about how to do this. Let me move this out of the way. I'm going to push this forward so it's out of the way. And then let me bring in the other elements here. So here is one of those frames from the Frames and Trims pack. You know what, I do need to bring this back for a second. This right here is also from one of the ephemera packs. I think this is Thrift Shop, and I think this is from Traveler. And these are all cut out. They're all pre-made and ready to go. And all I did was glue them on here. Again, I've used the 3D foam squares to lift this and give it some elevation. You only get one of each of these in the package, so I had to figure out an alternate. I knew I liked this look, and I'm going to come back and I'm going to use the mirrored stars, but you got to figure out a way to get this without being able to have those pieces. And so my solution was, first of all, let's do this. This is going to go like this. My solution was to take a rectangle of the piece of paper, just from the back of one of the pieces of paper. I came in again with the walnut stain and the ink blending tool, and I distressed this quite a lot because I wanted it to stand out from the background. And this is one of those little moths that I was telling you about a second ago from the Thrift Shop ephemera pack. You can see there's a little bit of glitter on there. I used some of the stickles in the color Mercury Glass just to add a little bit of oomph to it. And you can see that I've already got my 3D foam squares on the back. So I want to assemble this, and what I want to do is bring in, this is the Frames and Trims Industrious Stickers. Sorry, my brain went totally blank there for a second. So you can see that I've already got the top one of these on. I'm just going to grab another piece. I'm going to turn this toward me. Actually, I'm not going to turn it toward me. I'm going to turn it this way. Now this one, let's start from this side, because you can see here that they kind of begin and end at one of the little scallops. That worked out pretty well, so I want to do that from this side. Just going to lightly touch it. Now, as long as you don't handle the back of these very much, there's enough adhesive on there for them to stay in place. But if you do anything that interferes with that adhesive, then you will need to add a little bit more. But it's very fortunate that this piece, as it's cut from the 12 by 12 piece of paper, actually gives you a length over here that ends evenly. So there's no fiddling around to try to make those fit. All right, so let's get this out of the way just for a second. So this is going to go like this, and then I actually have to come back and look at the original. What I've done is this piece is actually elevated from the background piece, so I need to bear that in mind. What I will do, and I'm not going to do all of this now, but what I will do is come in again with the 3D foam squares. And because this is a big piece and because I don't want to ever have anybody touch this and then have it cave under their fingers, I'm actually going to put a lot of them on there. I would much rather do this than have an element that I spent so much time creating get ruined. So I'll basically fill in the back so that it looks like what you see here. And that'll be that. Before I do that, however, let's talk about, let me bring this back in. Let's talk about this special delivery. Again, you only get one per, so I don't have something else. I decided to manufacture something else instead. These are index labels. Is that what these are called? Yep, index labels. All I did was take some of the words from one of the rub-ons, probably the botanicals, and I went ahead and applied them. And now what I'm going to do is just go ahead and, let's see how this looks. I'm just going to touch it lightly because I'm not really certain I want to put it in place. Well, unfortunately, this isn't quite long enough to totally cover all of the text that's here, so I think I'm just going to do my best, kind of center it so that it's straight, and call that done. So even though it's not a little parcel post sticker, this works just as well. All right, so that's done. Now let's see, where else am I? I need to come back here for 1 second and look. Okay, so now we need to come to this really cool bird inside this frame. When I did the first one, let me bring this in. Here's what it looks like. This is the 12 by 12 piece of paper. Here's the frame. Now it's not on there straight, obviously, but basically what I did was align the frame, determine how I needed to cut it out, and that's how I got my center, excuse me, how I got my piece centered in this frame. What I'm going to do the second time instead, because I like it and I think it looks really cool, if I could put my hands on it. I had it all set too so I could show you. Okay. Feeling like the village idiot. Give me 1 second, I will find it, and I'll be right back. Okay, I'm back. Here is my piece. Now, what I've done this time is, rather than cut a big chunk around of the bird out, around the bird, rather, as I cut it out, so I would get the background, I fussy cut the entire bird out. And what I've done is I've got his head peeping through and over the frame. I think it looks really cool like this. Again, layers and loft and all of those elements that make things so interesting. So I'm just going to grab a pencil and I'm going to lightly trace around this so I get an idea of where I need to go ahead and cut this. And hopefully I'll be able to see this. I know I'm going to have to cut in just a little bit from around here. And sometimes you have to kind of play a little bit. I've been really careful not to adhere that on there too tightly. Sometimes you can play around a little bit with the adhesive and you don't run into any trouble. So let's see how this looks. All right, so the bird is basically all set. Actually, I take that back. You know what? I need to trim just a little tiny bit around the breast and just trim some of that off. All right, so there's that. Now what I need to do, and of course I've lost the spot that I had here. Here it is. That's kind of where I was. So I'm just going to kind of cut an oval out of this. And this may be too large to start with, but I would rather cut it too big than find that I've got a big gap in the background here. So again, assuming that the bird is going to go something like this. If I lay this on here, that's looking pretty good. Well, except that this bird is not exactly the way it needs to be. All right, fiddling, fiddling, fiddling. So now I can put this on here, and I'm pretty close. I just need to do a little bit of trimming along here. But you see the process and how this works, and what this does is it gives you a little bit more three-dimensional element than my original one. And of course, you can do whichever you like. But basically, that's it. Now I'll have to come in and I'm going to do some gluing. Obviously there's adhesive on the back of this, but I want to get the bird glued to the background and I want to get this all stable. So that's that. And then it will end up, whoops, on here looking something like this. So now my piece will look a little bit like that. And then what will happen, let me bring in the journal, or the folio rather, that I'm working on. So I'm going to flip this over. open this up, and this is about how this is going to look. I'm going to line this up, and again, I had this placed so carefully, so I was supposed to be able to just reach for everything I needed. What I've done is I've cut a piece of paper from one of the large sheets of paper that actually has elements on it. Well, let me bring this back in. I actually cut some of this out from one of the pieces of paper. I'm going to put that along here. I am looking, but I can't see where I put that. So what I'll, oh, there it is. Who knew? So what I'm going to do is put this along here, like this, and I'll just glue this in place and kind of center this along the bottom. And then again, I've got my foam squares on here to elevate this. Same thing here, this piece is going to be elevated and centered on here. And then this will basically be done, but for adding the two mirrored stars, kind of like this. Again, I would use the Aileen's, the super thick tacky glue, because you've got a non-porous surface on here because these backs are plastic or metal or whatever they are. So that's that. Let me just close this up, and then I want to talk a little bit about the other elements on the inside here. Here's my page, my inside cover of my folio, and this is basically now I've got everything I need for it. So let's come in here. Again, these pieces are from one of the ephemera packs. That's what this is, and of course the parcel post sticker. These are just pen nibs, and again, layers. This is just a strip of paper that I cut off to fit the width of this upper flap. I layered one of the narrow borders from the frames and trim set over it. This is a rub-on, probably from the botanical set, and pen nibs. I think that these look great. I glued a pen nib to this circle that came from the ephemera pack. Easy peasy, so easy and so much fun. This is that same moth. Again, it's making a lot of appearances. I think that it helps pull everything together when you see elements that are repeated. This is just a words from one of the botanicals rub-ons. I want to show you the arrow. This is one of the adornments that's called arrow, and this is a jump ring and a muse token. I want to show you how this works. So the way that the arrows come from the package, they are perfectly flat, so that they lay flat on a surface. However, the minute you put a jump ring on this, the back of this is no longer going to be flat. It's going to rest, it's going to rest on that jump ring. You know what, let me put this all together and then it'll make sense. This is a muse token, and I had my sandpaper out, so I went ahead and sanded it too, which kind of makes the lettering look more like raised relief on here because they're so much lighter now. So all I'm going to do is slip that on the jump ring. I need two pairs of pliers to close the jump ring. Ideally, I'd have three hands to close the jump ring, but I'm going to have to I'm going to have to make do with just the two that I have. All right. So, putting this back on here. Trying again. It's just a question of twisting and getting that jump ring nice and tightly closed. So what you end up with is this really cool element, but it won't lay flat because of the jump ring. So what you have to do, what I did, was I put just a little bit of a bend in the center of the arrow. All you have to do is press it ever so slightly, and if I show this to you, let's see, if I show this to you now, you can see that there's a bend right here. What that's going to do, first of all, is it's going to allow me to glue the two ends. Now the arrow in the center, this piece of whatever this is on the arrow, is not going to be adhered to the page, but underneath the arrowhead and underneath the feathers, it will be, again with the super thick tacky glue, and that means that I'll have all of this in place and I'm not really worried. This will slide a little bit, but again, I'm not worried about that. So that's how you get this really cool piece right here. We talked about these earlier. These came from one of the sheets. I cut the wings off. This is just a strip of paper, and then there are some more of the botanicals rub-ons, just words from that sheet. So this is basically my inside as it's going to remain. The only thing that I haven't done, I haven't figured out what I'm going to do in here, and then the other thing that I need to do is then talk about how I'm going to finish this. And you have a couple of options. I think that my sewing machine might, if I was super careful, I might be able to actually sew this down so that all of these act like little pages and they all cascade out, but I don't think I want to go there. The other option is I could put holes in here and I could put this in with something like a pamphlet stitch, and again it would all work like this. Or the other option is to glue this down just like this, so that this last piece in this spine actually becomes part of the inside of the center panel of your collection folio. I'm still playing with that. I have to figure that out, but that's what I'm going to do now, and then I'll be back and we'll talk about how to put all of these elements together and finish the inside of your folio. I've done some preliminary work to the spine. I've got color and texture on here. I used Distress Paint and the mini blending tool through Tim's Stencils. I came back and I reused the honeycomb that you saw me use earlier, and in addition to that I used Harlequin and Stars, and this is called Schoolhouse. And you can see that I picked up colors from within the project, kind of staying within that green and brown and black palette. I didn't want to introduce anything else. I think it would be a little bit distracting. Now, obviously, I'm going to attach a lot of things to this spine, and if I were going to bring it to the sewing machine and actually stitch anything on, I would want to do that before I put the spine in the book, or in the folio rather, but I know that I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to sew anything, so I've already made some plans about how this is going to go in place. I know that I need to align this over here, and then once I get this in place, I have another piece that's going to go right over the top of it. So the first thing I want to do is, obviously, I'm taking a look to make sure that everything's lined up the way that I expected it to be. And I'm going to do the same thing with the score tape that I have previously, which is to go ahead and loosen the release paper so that I can get this off easily once I kind of have this in place. Now, if you're using liquid glue, then obviously you're working with a little bit different animal and you don't have to do this, but you know that glue and I don't get along too well. So once I have this kind of where I want it to be, I'm going to get it, I'm leaning forward here so I can see. I'm going to get this all aligned, and then I'm going to pull the first piece of release paper off and just let this drop right into place because I know it's where it needs to be. And I'm going to lift up the back. And I'm going to do the same thing. And for me, this is just the easiest way to get good results and not to make a giant mess. So now that I have the spine in place, I can think about embellishing the spine. Because really, as I said earlier, if you wanted to pamphlet stitch through here using some floss or some pearl cotton or something, you'd actually have to come through and put holes in the folio itself, which I've chosen not to do. But I do want to conceal this last piece of the spine. And so what I've done, I've come back to this bird again because I really like it, and I picked up another one of the frames from the Trims and Frames Industrious Sticker Set. So this is the whole piece. This would be the 12 by 12 piece of paper, and what I did was cut it in such a way that I knew it was going to cover the spine, and then I cut the bird out because obviously he's part of the design of this page, and a little bit of the branches here, and then I inserted the frame around him, like I did here, except on the other one, obviously, he's peeping, his beak is over the top, and I wanted to do that here as well. So once again, I've got the same thing. I've got my score tape in place. Now, this is going to have to be dealt with a little bit separately, but first I want to go ahead and get the release paper off the score tape, and then just go ahead and lay it back down there. Oops, that's not what I want to do. Kind of need it to be where it needs to be. All right, that's better. Score tape is some sticky stuff. Okay, so I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this back piece in place first. So this piece first, and then before I pull the other strip, I'm going to get some glue underneath here. So let's see what we've got here. Actually, you know what? I probably can't do it that way. Thinking about that now. You know what? I can. I can make that work. So I've got this all lined up where I want it to be, and now what I'm going to do is just pick this up from here and peel that release paper off, if I can get my finger on it. All right, now I know that this shifted. I can feel that it shifted. So before I have an unhappy event, I'm just going to start again. Trying to get my fingers under there has proven to be a real challenge on this one. All right, in she goes. So now what I'm going to do is just bring in a little bit of the Scotch Quick Dry adhesive, and I'm just going to put a little bit under here, a little bit here, kind of hold everything in place. I'm going to scooch a little bit around on the frame itself because I have been handling this a lot, and I'm not confident that I haven't compromised the adhesive. So I'm just going to lightly wipe this here and here. Take the glue off my finger and then just let this all drop in place. Now I'm going to hold this just for a second because I need the quick dry adhesive to go ahead and settle on there, so it's just going to take a moment for that to happen. And I think that this makes such a difference. Now I don't have to see just the inside of that piece. I like this better. I think it kind of creates a more finished look. All right, so that seems pretty good. And that's really the joy of that adhesive. It's quick. It really does do its thing very quickly. So now the question becomes, okay, so what am I going to do to the spine? And really, you can do so many different kinds of things. And I want to bring in some elements that I've worked on. Now these are all from one of the ephemera sets, or rather these are both from one of the ephemera sets. However, when you look at the pieces as they come from the sets, they're really nice, but the backsides are blank. And since these are intended, no matter where you put this on the spine, you're going to see the other side. So what I've done, obviously all the paper in the pack in the wallflower paper stash is double-sided. So all I did was come in and put something else on the back, and of course, layers, layers, layers. I have a piece of paper, a crumpled piece of the craft glassine, and then one of the pieces from the ephemera pack, and then I just went ahead and put some of the rub-ons from the botanicals, remnant rubs, on there, and I think that this looks great. Same thing going on here, except that this time I used just a little bit of that same mercury glass glitter, just so, again, for a little continuity to pick that up. So these are some of the things that you can do. This is one of the found relatives cards. Again, layers and stacks. Paper and crumpled craft glassine, one of the found relatives cards. I trimmed this with a piece from the Industrious Borders the Industrious Stickers border set. And then this is really cool. This is from the Monocles set. They come out of the package looking like this. They have, so you can hang them if you want. They have this jump ring on them. But I knew that I wasn't going to hang this, so I just used my pliers, opened the jump ring up, took it off, and I'll just save that. I'll use it for something else. Now, again, we're looking at metal here. So what I did was I used some of the Aliens, the super-duper thick tacky stuff, because it's multi-surface and it'll work. Now, I would advise you that if you've touched the glass, you might want to clean it off before you put it down, because if you smudge the underside, once you glue it, you're not going to be able to pick it back up to clean it off. So obviously this is something that could go in here like this. I mean, there's just so many different things. There are elements that you go ahead and cut from the pieces of paper themselves. Here are some eggs. There's another leaf around here someplace, the really long one, which I can't put my hands on at the moment, but nevertheless. So these are some things that you can use to attach to your spine. What else do we have? Here we have, these are compass coins. And these are the game spinners. They come in two separate packages. They're two separate ideology pieces, but you just take them out, put them together like this, go ahead and spread the legs on the brad, and then you have this little interactive thing. Again, I would use the Aliens, the super duper thick tacky glue, to put this down because this is metal and we want it to adhere. I could bring in, these are hinge clips. These are so cool. You can use them to clip something in place. For example, if I wanted to use the hinge clip to put this in place like this, I absolutely could, which means that I have this interactive piece that could be moved afterwards. So I think that that's really interesting. What else? Here are some more pieces. This is from the thrift shop ephemera pack. We talked about these earlier, all these wonderful little elements here. Something else that's really cool, obviously we've used one of the large arrow adornments. There are multiple ones in the sets and there are two sizes. So here is the smaller arrow adornment. Again, just go ahead and glue it in place. Whether you put it on the spine, whether you put it down like this, or whether you make it part of one of the embellishments as you build all of these wonderful layers. Here's something else. We can use the index labels, these just peel and stick. Whether you do what I did on the other example of this here, which was to put a remnant rub on there, or you go ahead and just write a note in there or something like that, you can then start sticking these all over the place. These are heart charms. You get a bunch of them in a package. They come 12 to pack like this. They come with a pre-made little epoxy sticker that actually sits over the top. And then there are all these wonderful little hearts that are all ready to go. They're self-adhesive, and all you have to do is peel them off here. So I'm going to take this one off. And all you have to do is very carefully, obviously you want to get this aligned properly in the little heart. Oops. Some days my fingers feel far too big for my hands. There we go. So that's in there like that. And then you just go ahead and pick up one of these little plastic pieces that goes over the top. And because everything is self-adhesive, it's pretty quick and pretty easy. I mean, you saw how quickly I had this together. And here it is. Now let me show you something else that's really cool. This is a ring fastener. They come with the legs of the brads pushed through already, and they come with a jump ring on them. Now, because I'm not going to put this through paper, I actually came in with my wire cutters and I clipped the legs of the brad even with this little decorative piece right here. So that means that I can use some adhesive and I can put this down, and now I have this really cool embellishment. My thought is to probably do something like put it, let me just move this so you can see. I think I might tuck it right in here like this. And then I'll have this little dimensional element that sits up off the piece like that. I mean, there's just a myriad of ways. You saw me use pen nibs. You know, anything pretty much that you can think of to use, then by all means go ahead and use it. And nothing says that you can't come in and just lay some of the borders from the Industrious stickers, whether it's the border set or the narrower frames and trim set. Lots and lots and lots of different ways that you can do that. So how you go ahead and put all these elements together is really up to you. And if I wanted to, it could be an entirely different video that would just be building all the elements for that. So I can't, you know, do too much more of that today. But the last thing that I want to show you, and let me just take all of this stuff out of here so that I can close it up properly, would be the hinge clip that I'm going to use on the cover. And this hasn't actually been present at all yet. I haven't shown this to you yet, but it's something that I worked on much earlier in the project. So let me close these pieces and do this. Whoops. So this spot has been open right from the beginning, and it might have looked like it needed something, or it might have looked like I just left it like that intentionally, but my plan was always to use one of these hinge clips. They come two to a pack like this, and they're a squeezy thing, like what would go on a clipboard. Now, what I have done, because of the way these sit, they actually, this one won't show it, because, and I don't have the other one handy, but this piece that you squeeze to open actually sits below this, so I've put this little backer on here. It's just a piece of paper, a little strip that I cut, that I folded up so that it lifts the hinge clip up a little bit. Again, I'm working on metal, so I use the Alien Super Duper Thick Tacky Glue to put that in, to put the paper on the back of the hinge clip. And now all I have to do, again, is bring in the glue, and I can go ahead and put this in place. And this really is, aside from finishing the inside, this really is the last component of this project. Now I'm using a substantial amount of glue here. I need to take some of that off. But I want to be certain this is something, not that I plan on actually using it, but if someone were to actually pinch it, I don't want it to pop off. That would not be good at all. So I want to get an ample amount of glue on here. Now what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to put this in place, and I'm going to bring it toward me and just kind of, actually, you know, if I were clever, this is what I would do. Bring in a ruler and see where I am in terms of being centered. All right, so 2 5/8, give or take. And almost the same. So I'm going to shift this way a little bit, and I'm going to go ahead and press it in place. And now it's just a question of leaving it alone to let it dry. So here is, obviously I can't open this up because I put the hinge clip on it, but here is what this project ends up looking like. I'm really, really pleased with it. I'm really happy with the second one as I've kind of gone along and made progress on it. And I really hope that you join me and you make one of these collection folios. Obviously, this is the large one. There's a smaller version available as well. And both of them make a really beautiful project.